Welcome to my fifth class about regression. This class is dedicated to incremental iterative methods. First, what do I mean by iterative versus incremental? Let's illustrate three ways to perform regression here. The first way is what we have seen so far, which is batch regression. In that particular case, you have all the data points into a single batch, and then you perform a single calculation, which is an analytical calculation, which gives you the model that you are looking for just by one calculation. Okay. The second way is the iterative approach. You also start with the same batch of data, but you take a first model, you improve it, and little by little you iterate on the model until the error that the model is making with respect to the batch of data gets lower than some threshold that you have set. And the third way is the incremental method. As you can see, this is also an iterative method where you improve the model into a loop. But the difference is that usually you start with less data than in the previous methods. But at each iteration in the loop, you add new data. And a very important thing is that you can perform the equivalent of batch regression by just taking all your batch of data and putting it little by little into the iterative loop of improving the model. And this will provide you a model similar to the one that you would get with a batch method, but with a less expensive calculation, which is performed into a loop. Okay. But as you will see, this will raise an additional issue, which is when to stop improving your model. That's the problem of overfitting. Okay. So, how can I perform some incremental methods given what I've explained to you mathematically so far? As I told you in the previous classes, in the analytical case, you can get the optimal parameters for your model just by performing a single calculation. I've taken here one of the possible formulae. There are different variants as you have seen in the previous classic, but using, for instance, this formula, it requires inverting that particular matrix where G is the gram matrix corresponding to your data. Okay. And the point is that inverting this matrix is cubic in the number of dimensions. So for instance, if you have a very large linear architecture or a deep neural network, you have many, many dimensions, and this is getting too expensive to be performed onto a computer. Okay. So incremental solution brings some improvement to respect to that. One first way to perform incremental computation of the inverse of the matrix is to use the Sherman-Morrison lemma. Okay. So this method is quadratic instead of cubic, and it performs incremental update of the inverse by adding new data points again and again into the inversion process. The point with this method is that it is sensitive to rounding errors. So there is a numerically more stable option, which corresponds to updating the Cholesky factor of the matrix that you want to invert using a particular algorithm, which is called QR, and that I won't explain here. So you will have to find some references if you want to know more about this. And in the particular case of linear regression, the incremental method is known as the recursive least square, which is an incremental way to perform the least square regression that I have explained to you in the second class. Now let's illustrate how incremental regression works in practice with a specific case where I want to find that particular latent function, so I don't know this function, and I have defined my model as a collection of Gaussian functions associated to weights. And what I want to find is the correct weights. Okay, so in the beginning, all the weights are set to zero. So the sum of my Gaussian models times the weights is zero itself. So my model corresponds to this flat red line. Then I take a first point, for instance, here. And what I will do with my incremental technique is that I will increase the weights corresponding to the Gaussians that are around the data point that I have added to my model. Okay. Actually, what I do here is that I will represent the fact that I have increased the weights by using a larger and larger Gaussian. Okay, that's not mathematically accurate. What I am doing is just increasing a weight, and the Gaussian itself is not increasing, but I illustrate this just by increasing the size of the Gaussian. So what I show you with the blue line is the Gaussian times the weight. Then I take a second data point here and I generate a very small bump here because the distance here is small. Then a third data point, and you can see that little by little, increasing the weights in the area where I shoot lower, get the distance between the latent function and my model lower, makes it that the weights are increasing here and that my model is making a larger bump, and so on and so on. And you can see that the more points that I will take in this particular area, the larger will be the bump because it's trying to go towards those data points that I have shown you incrementally. And again, okay. You can see that at some point I will get some negative values here. So here I will need to get some negative weights associated to the Gaussian. So I represent this as a negative Gaussian function. Okay. And I'm continuing, and you can see that along the process, the model is getting closer and closer to the latent function until some points where it exactly fits the model. Okay. So I have presented to you how I can slowly fit my latent function by incrementally adding data points and moving the weights so as to fit the corresponding function better and better. Okay, but in that particular let's say simulation, I have taken the particular case where the data points are always exactly on the latent function, so my model exactly fits the latent function. But this might not be the case in practice. Okay, in practice, in general, what you get is that the measurements corresponding to your data points are noisy, so they are not always on the latent function itself. You want to fit with those blue dots, you want to find a function that is something like this one. Okay, so what I will show you is that I will play the same simulation in that particular case, and let's see what's happening. Okay, so first, in the beginning, as in the previous case, my model is completely flat because all my weights are zero. After a few iterations, I get a model that is something like this. A few more iterations, and I get something, like this. Okay, so I am closer to what I want to fit because I am trying to minimize the error to my blue dots. But if I continue minimizing the error to my blue dots, I will end up doing something like this. So you can see that my model is going through most of my data points, so I am very happy with in terms of error to the data points. But this function is not a good model of the latent function because it's overfitting noise. Okay, so I am trying to model the function with the noise, whereas I should remove the noise. That's what is called overfitting. Okay, so the question is that since I in the previous iteration I was there, which was better, and now I am there, which is worse, when I shall I stop iterating over my model? Okay. And there is a good methodological answer to that particular question. This consists in using a validation set. So what you do is that you have your training set corresponding to your batch of data points, and you split it into two parts. A larger part, which is the training subset, and a smaller part, which is the validation subset. Okay. And what you do is that you train on the training set, but at each iteration, you evaluate the quality of your model with respect to the validation set. Okay? So if you are overfitting the data points in your training set, probably you will be worse on the validation set. So when the performance on the validation step stops improving, it means that you should stop iterating. And if you are doing so, probably you will generalize well from the training set to the validation set, so also from the training set to the test set, which corresponds to the data points that you have not seen before, on which you have not trained at all. In the overfitting process, the size of the model or the richness of the model has a strong influence. So for instance, if you want to fit this particular latent function with a linear model, probably your best fit is not very good. You still get a large difference. So even if you are using the validation set trick, what will happen is that your training error may not go down towards zero because you cannot do better than this, and this is very far from a zero error. Okay? So what you should rather do is select a rich enough model and then use the validation trick to decide when to stop, rather than try with not rich enough model where you probably won't be able to decrease the error up to zero. So deep neural networks are a particularly rich class of models, and the good idea is probably to training them with gradient descent using the validation trick, and this is what I will explain to you in the next class. Again, thank you for listening, and see you in the next class.